Hello, my name is Hakeem Roys, aka your boy, Brother Royce, one time for your mind, oh. I'm mainly known for doing hip-hop, as music is my passion, and it is what I love to do. In addition to being an artist, I'm also an actor, writer, film producer, public speaker, youth counselor, martial artist, and fight film choreographer. But what about the man behind all those things? When the lights turn off and the crowds are gone and all the fancy jewelry and clothes come off, where do I go when I need to replenish, rejuvenate, and restore my mind, heart, and soul? Yo, 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 what's good? It's your boy, Brother Royce, one time for your mind, oh. And I'm here with the boy.
It's David Miller, Pompano's Culture Arts Ambassador.
And we are the Lightworkers Podcast. Hey, check this out. In the second month of the year 2022, I took my second trip to Ghana, West Africa.
February.
Yo, that trip was so impactful, and that trip is so important for every black person to make. Yo, we decided when I got back that we're going to do a documentary on it.
Yes, and it's my pleasure. It's kind of like my honor to be able to work with Hakeem for touching the motherland himself. And I feel like as Culture Arts Ambassador, I got to be the one to help unify that Africa and America, you know? So, yeah. This is just us bringing that South Florida flavor, because you know a lot of people done a lot of things, but you never heard some young brothers from South Florida touch the motherland and talk about it like the way we talking about it. So we gonna do what we can to bring them up to speed on everything going on 2022.
That's right. So I would like to congratulate you, because you get to be the first people to take the Glue-Alkebulan tour. So sit back and relax, and we are gonna walk you through 2 weeks in Ghana, West Africa. And if after this you wanna take the trip for yourself, then we'll also be able to help with that as well. So let's get started. Check. Yeah, welcome online. We here. Getting ready for something phenomenal. We're gonna take our second trip to the motherland, Africa, Ghana. This time we're gonna have a lot more fun. We got a lot of stuff in store, got a lot of stuff in the works, so let the adventure begin.
went to Africa, yep. 2018. That has been a while ago.
Your first trip.
Yep. So what country you landed in, and give us a little bit about what you got from that trip.
Country we went to was Ghana. We went to Ghana, West Africa, and I mean, definitely don't be afraid to go. Definitely don't be afraid to make that trip. You know what I'm saying? And don't be afraid of that. You know, we are trailblazers. You know, and not that we're the first ones to do it worldwide. Not be the first black people to go to Africa. You know what I'm saying? Even in 2022, we're not the first ones to go over there. But you know, we are trailblazers, as in, you know, we are the first ones, at least in our peer group. You know what I'm saying? To kind of go over there and break that wall. You know, a trailblazer is just that. Somebody who breaks the wall, you know, whether with the head, hands, or feet. Yeah. You know, we put that hole in the wall to open it up for other people to kind of go. We the first ones. We break that fear barrier. You know what I'm saying? So definitely don't be afraid to go.
I just want to give a little mention, right? In 2018, it's almost a thing that just goes on. 2018, we had a nasty Valentine's Day massacre out there in Parkland, man, a school shooting. This thing been happening here in America. And
almost commonplace.
It almost is common. So when that happened, the teenagers ran around nationally speaking on school shootings, you know? And that kind of supercharged me to become a person that be active in my community. So in 2018, I ran for city commissioner in my city. 2018, you took a trip to Africa. So
first
that was your first time on it. Exactly, yes. First time.
I feel like over there gives us the place to heal from everything that we have witnessed and been through here. Yeah. There's a saying that says you can't heal in the place where you got sick.
Yeah.
So whether you visit or whether you live, you know, you finding out whether or not you have a place over there, at least going over there will give you a chance to heal and restore and recover your mind so that now you can see where the place is that you could have over there. But I say, I know where we have a place over there. It's bringing the knowledge and bringing the understanding that we have gained from our time here.
Because this, in a sense, it is a time travel.
Yeah.
And I'm going to explain why it's a time travel. But wise words, bro.
Yeah.
You can't heal where you became sick at.
You're constantly being re-traumatized. So how do you ever heal? There was a shooting in 2018. We just had a mass shooting this month.
Buffalo.
It's happened again, the 27th school shooting in the United States this year. We're in May. This one is by far the toughest to take.
A small Texas city is in shock. Our nation is reliving this nightmare nearly a decade after those young students at Sandy Hook were killed.
The elementary school there in Uvalde, Texas is now the scene of the second deadliest school shooting in our nation's history. 19 children and 2 teachers were killed. President Biden has ordered all flags on federal ground to fly at half staff.
The victims, little children, 3rd and 4th grade, gunned down just ahead of summer break. How sad, how sick, how enraging that our schools are not safe. More than 40 school shootings in just the last year. Hundreds of thousands of American children have been subjected to gun violence since Columbine. All the deadliest etched in our collective memory. Parkland, Sandy Hook, now Uvalde.
New York. So how do you heal when you're constantly being re-traumatized?
Damn.
Once you That's go crazy. To a place where, I just explained the culture of Africa, once you can go to a place where you have the peace in order to heal, then you can see the world from the perspective that you need to find out where you do and do not fit. But if you're constantly being traumatized, you're always living in survival mode. I didn't realize it even until I got there.
Yeah.
And as far as that, I had a subconscious understanding kind of, and it wasn't, but a subconscious belief system. Okay.
There you go.
That every place that there are black people is some kind of violence or savagery. You know what I'm saying? And to put that into context, you know, where we from here, you know what I'm saying, or any urban city in America, you know, you're surrounded by shooting and violence and impoverishment and disenfranchisement and no opportunities and kind of a hopelessness, you know what I'm saying, in a survival mode, you know what I'm saying, and everybody's traumatized, and I mean, you have, you know, there's a lot of PTSD. You have post-traumatic stress disorder, which is when somebody comes back from war. And people get therapy for that, you know what I'm saying? But we have post-traumatic slave disorder, you know what I'm saying? We never received any therapy from slavery. And whether you say it's 265 years of actually being on the plantation, then another 100 or so years of just going through the same mental conditions, or whether you just really understand that the whole 400 years was different levels of mental traumatizing, you know what I'm saying? We never went through any kind of a real healing from that, you know what I'm saying? So that really creates the conditions of how we deal and interact with each other. So now, being in Ghana, it was a culture shock. It was definitely a culture shock, you know, because that was my first experience seeing black people live together in peace. And I didn't think that was possible.
Wow. And we here in one of the richest nations on this planet, and blacks are still acting like we gotta be savages with one another.
So
now you've been, we're talking 2018, because we do know you went this year, 2022.
Yeah.
But 2018, your first time in Africa, wow, man, I ain't never been, so I'm trying to get it out of you right now.
Yeah.
As you was on that soil, you feel me, who is you with? Like, a tour guide?
That was actually one of my first times actually meeting with Elong, who was the guy for my second trip. And also with Elong, I was also with another brother named Kocho.
We're here.
Yeah, we are here. Now it's morning.
Yes.
The sun is shining.
Yes.
Yeah, like nobody's business.
Yeah.
And I actually spent most of the time with Kocho.
Nice.
And me and Kocho and the other African people, and we talked about everything. We talked about Tupac Shakur. We talked about the slave trade.
Tupac,
yeah, Tupac is like a hero over there. He's a hero over there. And I mean, over there, you know, people don't even speak, and it's really around the world, people who don't even speak English, but they know the English lyrics to his song. So maybe the only words they know in English is the lyrics to a Tupac song.
Wow.
That's how much they know him. In Africa, there are armies who name their generals who get high ranking in the army, the Shakur army.
Whoa.
Tupac Amaru Shakur, that's the name they give to their generals.
Nice.
In Africa, you know. So he's not just hailed over there for his music, he's hailed over there for his boldness, how he spoke the truth to power, how he didn't back down to anybody. In Africa, those things are celebrated, not so much in America. So it's just a part of that whole, that's a part of what I'm talking about with the culture shock. You know what I'm saying?
Wow.
remember this. Mm-hmm. I'm sitting with Kojo, right? And we, after we get done talking about Tupac and talking about the culture and everything, mm-hmm. and just telling about the violence and some of the things we go through over here, mm-hmm. and we ride a scooter from where he works to where he lives. And he said, man, we're going to walk today. I'm going to leave the scooter here. We're going to walk today. So we go walking. It's about 3 o'clock in the morning. Mm. And he said, I wanted to show you this. Come on. So we look, and he says, look over here. This is what I wanted to show you. And there is an elderly lady outside in front of her corner store, in front of her stand at 3 in the morning, selling soda pops or candies or a little hot plate with bread and egg to whoever passes by, whoever want to buy. Wow. And it's 3 in the morning. And he says, look, he said, you know how that lady is able to be out in front of her store, store wide open, at 3 o'clock in the morning like that? I said, yeah. He said, there's no crime over here. He said, for even fighting, for even two black people in the street fighting, he said, they will lock you up and throw away the key for something like that, you know, and metaphorically.
But still, and within that being said, that's something big for culture, because I'm like, an old lady, 3 a.m., making money.
Yeah.
Like, don't you know over here, like, 3 a.m. is like a witch hour. Like, ain't nothing good happening in that time in America. You got a 13-year-old late night will be like, she get that money. What she put her money in?
That's where a lot of them get killed. A lot of these young rappers, you know, when you hear about it, they got gunned down. They were walking the streets at night to get something to eat from a 24-hour store or to go to a corner store in the middle of the night, and they get gunned down. That's where a lot of these young guys get killed.
Man, do you think America encouraged or just don't stop violence? Do you think we really embrace violence? Like, go ahead and be
you gotta understand, ruthless. America created, you know, you can read books and you can watch documentaries called The Creation of the American Negro. Mm. And those books about the creation of the American Negro is how you turn a black man from an African into what they call a Negro. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And I mean, you can read Willie Lynch. You can read the Willie Lynch letters.
Back here, I have a foolproof method for controlling your black slaves. I guarantee every one of you that if it is installed correctly, it will control the slaves for at least 300 years. My method is simple. Any member of your family or your overseer can use it. I have outlined a number of differences among the slaves, and I take these differences and make them bigger. I use fear, distrust, and envy for control purposes. These methods have worked on my modest plantation in the West Indies, and it will work throughout the South. Take this simple little list of differences and think about them. On the top of my list is age, but it's only there because it starts with an A. The second is color and shade. There is intelligence, size, sex, plantation, status on plantation, attitude of owners, whether the slave lives in the valley, on the hill, east, west, north, south, have fine hair, coarse hair, or is tall or short. Now that you have a list of differences, I shall give you an outline of action. But before that, I shall assure you that distrust is stronger than trust, and envy is stronger than adulation, respect, or admiration. The black slave, after receiving this indoctrination, shall carry on and will become self-refueling and self-generation for hundreds of years, maybe even thousands. Don't forget, you must pitch the old black male versus the young black male and the young black male against the old black male. You must use the dark-skinned slaves versus the light-skinned slaves and the light-skinned slaves versus the dark-skinned slaves. You must use the females versus the males and the males versus the female. You must also have our white service and overseers distrust all blacks. But it is necessary that your slaves trust and depend on us. They must love, respect, and trust only us. Gentlemen, these kits are the keys to control them. Use them. Have your wives and children use them. Never miss an opportunity. If used intensely for 1 year, the slave themselves will remain perpetually distrustful. The speech was delivered by a white slave owner, William Lynch, on the banks of the James River in Virginia.
And the Willie Lynch letter says, hey, you know, we replace trust with distrust. Mm. We replace reverence with jealousy and envy. Mm. Now, in order for you to replace something, that means it had to already be there. So if you're reading the Willie Lynch, you can understand the conditions that they found us in. Wow. They found us respectful to each other. Yeah. They found us in reverence of each other. They found us in honor of each other. And the Willie Lynch letter says, as long as they're in this condition, we cannot make them into slaves.
We control it.
So we have to make them distrustful of each other. We have to make them jealous of each other. We have to make them envious of each other. We have to make divisions and make it look like they're against each other on all levels. The tall against the short, the fat against the skinny, the light against the dark, the women against the men, the old against the young. We have to create all of these divisions so that divide and conquer. You understand?
Yeah. Yeah.
So the conditions that we live in the inner city communities, it was created by the American system. So when you go back to Africa, you go back to before we were introduced to this system, and you really see the natural conditions, the natural.
So it's more love, you're saying it's more love.
It's unity. Mm-hmm. And it's a natural unity. It's not someone standing on the corner saying, hey, we need to be united. Example, we was walking through the marketplace and there was a guy that was selling fruits. And it was a big commotion, a bunch of people gathering around. And just to show you how like traumatized we are coming from over here, to me, when you see a big group of people gathering around, you think fight.
Oh yeah,
shooting,
yeah, yeah.
World Star, good. Something.
Everybody. Yeah.
So all of my like adrenaline and everything, oh, what's going on? Like, oh, there's some people gathering around. And that's how I am. I'm like, what's going on? And they're speaking in Tree, they're speaking in Swahili, yeah. And you know, finally the people start dispersing and everything, and Kojo walks over there, he doesn't walk too far, but then he comes back. And I said, what's going on? And Kojo's laughing. And he said that shopkeeper was trying to overcharge one of the ladies for fruits. So he said all the people gathered around him and they was gonna shut his stand down.
Dang. Court in the streets.
Yeah, because he was trying to be unfair with the price of the fruits.
Mm.
And I was like, they made a commotion like that. He was like, we don't do that here. He says, well, this.
Yeah, the culture, I see what you're saying.
Culture shock.
It's kind of, you kind of a shock.
So over here is get it by the knee. You know, the finessing is what's promoted in 2022. I'm a finesser.
You
know what I'm saying? And over there, they like, we just don't do that here. People, everybody works hard here, so we treat each other fair and just. And as we kept walking, I was just like, wow.
So this was what I meant when I said that my first trip really inspired me to make this second trip. And I am a youth counselor. And I work with youth in the inner cities a lot. And knowing how much the first trip changed me look at the condition of our youth and our inner cities. And I remember how I was before I made the trip. And I know that what it did for me, it could do for them as well. So we'll start by building tools. And the idea begins to come together from there. See your land. Meet your people. And experience a different way of life. Not only is it to heal, what we're going through here, but also to open your mind, expand your horizons, and to show you that there are opportunities out there if you want to break that mentality that I have, that every place in the world, it's like the ghettos and hoods of America. Which really gave me a confidence that I could achieve my dreams. It may involve traveling. It may involve a degree of getting out of your comfort zone. Even a degree of risk taking. But if I didn't want to accept the conditions that we were given, and I wanted to make a change, I wouldn't have to look towards what seems to be impossible odds and conditions trying to develop in a world like the one we come from. I could look towards the abundance of opportunities. Where we're from. I'm all for counseling and teaching the youth. They're less socially programmed. And if they could only make it through the environment that triggers the trauma in their genetics, trauma's passed down. So then they could find their potential quicker than many of the older it was. So today, that was the day I decided to become a part of organizing tours of the continent. My first stop, Ghana, West Africa.
Love you!
Yes!
Imagine Ghana like California with Sunset Boulevard, Johannesburg would be Miami, Somalia like New York with the most pretty light, the toughest pretty car, every New Year the African Times Square lock off. Imagine Lagos. Vegas, like Las Vegas. The ballers, them a ball. Angola like Atlanta, a pure plane take off. Bush Gardens in a Mali, Chicago in a Chad. Magic Kingdom in a Egypt, Philadelphia in Sudan. The Congo like Colorado, Fort Knox in Agyaban. People living in Morocco like the state of Oregon. Algeria warmer than Arizona, bring your sun lotion. Early morning class of yoga on the beach in Senegal. Ethiopia, the capital, be the congregation. And that's how I belong, and where the king come from.
I can see us all in limos, Jaguars and limos,
riding on the king's highway. There's a lot of work to be done, oh gosh, in the promised land.
Every day that I was there, I woke up early in the morning to get a nice, good workout in. It's a busy town. In the morning, everybody is up at their daily business. Preachers are praying over the town. Kids are off to school. The roosters are crowing. So every morning I'd get up and I'd either work out physically or mentally with a good book. Physically, do my push-ups, do my squats. do my squats, maybe even some shadow boxing. I wanted to get everything that I could out of this experience. I was determined to make the best of this trip. So every day before breakfast, the host would find me already up. Sweat. Mentally, I had to read a couple pages from a book. Or whatever else I had that could charge my mind and get me ready for the day ahead.
I am getting better and better. I am getting better.
Ready to take on the day.
Reading this book, Success Through a Positive Mental Attitude. I like this scripture. I like this, call it scripture. I like this book right here about a man who was dying. I'll read a little bit of it to you. It says, okay. He was only 20 years of age. His family was not wealthy. Yet it was particularly well esteemed. Therefore, six doctors and a young intern had struggled all night in a small operating room in San Juan, Puerto Rico, trying to save Rafael's life. Now, after 12 hours of unceasingly watchfulness and attention, they retired and sleepy. Try as they would, they were finally unable to hear his heartbeat. They couldn't find his pulse. Says, the doctors thought he could not hear what they were saying, and they spoke as if he were dead. One said, not even a miracle can save him now. Now the chief surgeons took off their surgical coats and prepared to leave the room. The young intern said, may I have the body? Yes, was the response. The doctors left the room. It has been written, so we do not lose heart, because we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen is eternal. They could see the physical body, but Rafael, like all of us, was a mind with a body. So it says, he began to speak to God as a friend, like a man talking with another. And next to this, I put, how do we speak to God? You know, in the West, we're learning that God is a part of self. We are a part of God. But never negate speaking with the omnipotent intelligence, the divine intelligence, the prime creator, the source. Because if we are pieces of God, then he knows your model. He knows you better than even you know yourself. So don't let the God within you replace the omnipotent God that created you, because we did not create ourselves. So this man on his deathbed begins speaking to God like a friend. We speak to God like a friend. We speak to God like a father, you know. It says, you know me, you are inside me, you are my blood, you are my life, you are my everything. There is but one mind, one principle, and one substance in the universe, and I am one with all else. If I die, I don't lose anything. I just change form. But I am only 20 years old, dear God. I am not afraid to die, but I am willing to live. If you choose to give me life, someday, somehow, I'll be able and willing through your mercy to lead a better life and to help others. You know, earlier in this book, it highlights a very powerful thing. And it says how to be prepared for an emergency. And how you are prepared for emergency is always have something to live for. A purpose, a drive, an ambition. You know, in the West, we're always trying to answer the question, what is my purpose? What is my drive? You know? And if you don't have an answer to that question, it's very easy for you to die. Because we face death all day long. The Bible says we face death all day long. We are a sheep led to the slaughter sometimes, you know. So the book on that says, how do you prepare for an emergency? Always have something to live for. Always have something to hold on to. And remember, when you have something to live for, the subconscious mind forces upon the conscious mind strong motivating factors to keep you alive in times of emergency. You know, so we know about gun violence and people being shot and everything, and some people pull through, some people don't. But when you have something to live for, sometimes just holding on to that can pull you through, you know, and even furthermore, when you have something to live for, a purpose, a drive, something beyond yourself that you are living for, something that even when you want to quit and you give up, it is beyond yourself. So it is not based on how you feel in any given moment. It is constantly pulling you forward. They said you could either be pushed by pain or pulled by a vision. And that was from a homeboy, my homeboy Muhammad. Yeah, you can be pushed by pain or pulled by a vision. So when you have a purpose, when you have a vision, it pulls you forward, it drives you forward. So, and he says, they say, where did you get the inspiration for this? Like, where did you get the, how did you know you can talk to God and do this as he did when he was unconscious? And it says, eventually the intern approached Raphael and looked at Raphael's face and observed the twitching of his eyelids and the teardrop falling from the corner of his left eye. So when they asked him, like, how did you believe you can do this? He said he read a book, Science and Health, with Key to Scriptures by Mary Baker Eddy. And it says, as proved by Raphael, inspirational books are tremendous instruments in changing lives. And there is no book with more inspiration and motivation than the Bible. The Bible has changed the lives of more persons than any other book. It has helped countless thousands to develop physical, mental, and moral health. Reading the Bible has developed a great understanding of its truths in many persons and caused them to draw closer, it says, to their own church, but I say draw closer to God. This is because the Bible has motivated them to positive action. So, you know, people have the incorrect assumption that reading the Bible is a Christian thing, but
Napoleon Hill doesn't claim any religion or anything, but he draws the inspiration for most of his books, and he attributes his success to reading the Bible. So it's not about reading the Bible as a religious book. Even if you read the Bible as a piece of literature, even if you read the Bible as a book of inspiration, get that inspiration in you. Get it in you. Get it in your subconscious mind. Get it programmed into your mind, because it will help navigate your path, and it will help give you that inspiration to live. You understand? We shouldn't be afraid to die, because we don't die. We do change form. But let's be willing to live. Morning motivation.
Always. Now y'all should know who it is. It's the boy David Miller, your culture arts ambassador, here with my boy.
You already know it's your boy, Brother Royce. One time for your mind.
I do.
You already know.
And we are the
Lightworkers Podcast.
Anyway, look, man. Lightworkers Podcast. I want to say, my brother Royce, man. Y'all don't forget the name. Shout outs to Akon. Shout outs to Ludacris.
Yeah.
Shout outs to Lil Jon.
Yeah. Shout out to Usain Bolt.
Usain Bolt. Okay. Woo. Don't forget the name Hakeem Roys, because we in Africa too. And I just wanted to end this little segment with that. You know what I'm saying? Thanks for going to Africa and bringing that knowledge back, baby. Lightworkers Podcast. Mm-hmm.
Say hi, I'm live. Yeah, so you are welcome.
I'm about to might try my shot at a couple alleys or whatnot. If I still got it. I hurt myself.
So I'm gonna introduce you to Justice.
Yeah.
He's one of the best surfers in Ghana. Justice! So if you want to surf, you know where.
Coming from the airport to here, I saw that even from 2018 to 2022, a lot of development has happened here. And I noticed, like maybe if you're here every day, it's like, oh yeah, you know, we're not going fast enough. But I instantly noticed like, wow, that wasn't there, and that wasn't there. And hey, like, so, you know, we used to ride with Kojo on the bicycles through the scooters, just throughout the town. Like Kojo used to ride me around the town. A lot of the roads are built now and are paved now. When I came, all of the businesses were in like the compartment. Some of the businesses are in buildings now.
Yeah.
So
the greatest opportunities for people.
Yeah, the amount of building and the amount of development that has happened here between 2018 and 2022 to me is amazing. Wow. And it's astonishing when sometimes you live in communities that never change, and now you see the place expanding so quick, you know. So it's
all right.
It's definitely gonna be the home for a lot of change.
So in this Willie Lynch document, you have the origin of division, and the division between the old man and the young child, colorism, the origins of the wars between the black man and the black woman. the origin of the wars between where you from, East Coast, West Coast, North, South, North Coast, you know, the North and from the South.
Now, I'm from the South. I love being from the South. But I never divide myself up as far as being better than East Coast, North Coast, Midwest, none of that. Shots out to everybody. East Coast, West Coast, North Coast, Midwest, all that.
You have the origins of picking on someone for the texture of their hair. Matter of fact, you have the origins for the fear and distrust and envy that we carry between one another. It said you must remember that distrust is stronger than trust. Envy is stronger than adulation, respect, or admiration.
When it comes to keeping them under control, and keeping them divided.
So when looking at the current condition of our people in America today and asking the question, where do you believe it comes from? This highlights where it comes from. As it says, if you follow these methods, it will control the slaves for at least 1,000 years. And it says, after receiving this indoctrination, it shall carry on and become self-refueling in the next generations for hundreds, maybe even thousands of years. It says you break them from one form of mental life to another form of mental life. You must break them from their natural state. So it says breaking them from their natural state. So distrust was not our natural state. Envy was not our natural state. These was used to break us from trust, respect, admiration, and adulation. And this is what you see when you go to the continent of Africa. I always asked, what were we like before slavery? And the trip in 2018, it really answered that for me. That's why I chose to return. But this time, I chose to return so now, the rest of us could experience this understanding. I found Adinkra symbols all over Ghana. All over Ghana, Adinkra symbols. And out of the 60 different Adinkra symbols, understanding what each one means will begin to reveal that original nature that we were broken from. They have Adinkra symbols for unity. Adinkra symbols for strength and preservation and never yielding one's position. Adinkra symbols for wisdom and intellect at figuring out a solution to any problem. They have Adinkra symbols for leadership. Adinkra symbols that says those who share the same stomach does not fight for food. think are symbols for strong marriage. A dinker symbols for reverence of God. A dinker symbols for interconnectedness. The popular African saying, I am because you are, and you are because we are, highlights the unity that there was amongst these farming people. So their job was to break us from this natural state. The process of breaking. The process of traumatizing the woman who is the mother of the children. The process of destroying the male to destroy the protective image in the minds of the black family. Training the young men to fear for their lives. Training the young women that they had to be independent. Because any male that wasn't already traumatized through the infant process could be taken away and killed and murdered at any point in time. And that what would be constant for the slave woman is being alone, only with the overseers to depend on. Without the protection of the male, a submission became necessary for survival. And this is trained into the children. In this document, you have underage pregnancy. For if the children were born slaves, they would be conditioned as to have the perfect mentality as soon as possible to make them into young parents that will continue the process. Likewise, here you have the origin of single mothers. For the male would be introduced to the female slaves only to breed with them. Then he would be instantly moved to another plantation, never to see his own child again. You have the origin of why women only see themselves as sexual objects. Because they were bred with different black slaves and bred with different slave masters. Since they could not be as strong as the male in the field, their value became their ability to breed children. Here, you have the origins of some of the most destructive mentalities that we carry today amidst our people. This is the trauma. And it even says, you must keep them from connecting to any substantial, original, historical base, for they fear that this will drive the mind to begin to correct and recorrect itself to its original state. Maybe there's a reason that a lot of people believe that this letter is fake, quote unquote. It really gives a hard, polarizing look at the conditions that we're in today. It shows that as long as we are subject to these behaviors, we are still enslaved in the mind.